dislikes is representative of the entire crypto community. And you know this for a fact. You are latching onto a certain token or a certain coin, and some of you become almost Gestapo-like. I mean, we have the Verge following. God forbid anybody speak badly about Verge. Trump. You know, I jokingly made the coin of the week the Doge coin, right? Which is the joke coin of this world, and believe it or not, it actually went up some. So the very few people who have humor, even in the humor, it's dark. I mean, what are the funniest things we see? We see Adolf Hitler in a movie representation going, "No fucking dog is taking us to the moon," and yet it's funny. But most of us are serious, and way too serious. And here's why. You know, we are kind of at war with each other. Promote my coin. Promote my ICO. If you don't, then, you know, F you. And so that's what it is. And yet we are really at war. This is the problem. I beg your pardon? Is that better? Okay. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. No, we are truly at war, and we should not be at war with each other. We are at war with the old world order. Yeah. And if you do not believe it, take any random day for the past 6 months and see if you can't find one piece of news which is negative toward the new order, the new paradigm, which is putting the old order upside down. We have banks that are no longer accepting payment for cryptocurrencies using their credit cards. We have governments outlawing ICOs, exchanges, and commerce using cryptocurrency. But has anything truly changed in terms of what we are able to do? No. Do you think the Chinese people are not using cryptocurrencies because there is legislation against it? Of course not. Half the problem with the dip that we've seen in the past few weeks was the Chinese waiting till the end of Chinese New Year to start using cryptocurrencies and investing again. This is what happens. We also have within this group almost a paranoid sense of, oh my God, it's crashing. What I'd like you to do is think about the following. The crypto world is compressed in time tremendously compared to the old world of fiat currency and fiat financing. Here's what happens. If I'm a company and I'm using fiat in the old world order, I've got a 30-day net return before someone's going to pay me. Even if I get an instantaneous wire transfer, it's not instantaneous. It takes 24 hours in many cases, especially if it's overseas. What does it take using Ethereum in most cases? A few minutes at most. So what's happening? The transactions are speeding up, because the person I give my currency to has to wait to get my currency before they can pay whatever they got their product from, for example. And it's instantaneous. So all of the fluctuations are compressed. Why don't you take Bitcoin's chart, stretch it by two orders of magnitude, and take a look at it. It looks just like General Motors, or Chrysler, or any other traditional company. So, obviously, when the analysts from the old world order start saying, oh my God, this is, you know, it's chaos, it is unstable. No, not at all. It's just that the instabilities in the old marketplace are being compressed. Just try it. Stretch it out by 100 times and take a look. No, it's just like, you know, for every few months there's an up and down in any traditional stock. So what's happening is that people are using the standards and the tools. Yeah, here's the problem with my glasses. Anyway. There, that's all. So the analysts in the old world order are using the tools, the functions, the concepts, the formulas, and the ideas that they grew up with and work. Well, those functions and concepts do not work in the world of crypto. Now, why are we at war? Number one, the old world order has a power structure that has been in place for thousands of years. Money flows to the top. Those at the top become powerful. The powerful become corrupt, and society becomes pushed down. We become sheep or slaves to the order that has existed for thousands of years. But what happens in cryptocurrency? We don't have anybody at the top. I need no one's permission to do what the hell I want with any of my wallets and any of my currencies. I can give them away, I can buy something. I don't have to call my bank and say, you know, would you transfer it? No, I've got it, I buy it. Nobody's permission is needed. And if I'm using a privacy coin like Monero, then nobody knows who I am, where I am, who the receiver is, or if I'm receiving, who the sender is. We are anonymous. And this is what scares people. It scares governments because most governments collect their revenues based on our income. I'm a libertarian. I believe that taxation is theft. It's not in our Constitution. But in the old order, try getting away with not paying taxes. In our order, try to collect those taxes. Try to find out my income. Think about it. This is the fucking thing. 80% of all of the revenues come from the sweat of your brow. The government saying, well, we don't care if it's your work. For 3 months, you're going to work for me and pay me. That's going to go away. Because how are they going to know what you bought, what you got, what you earned? It would require an enforcement officer for every human being in the world. It cannot be done. So governments are doing what they always have done, which is create legislation to try to solve the problem. In the 1930s, they legislated away alcohol. During that period, which we now call Prohibition, America consumed more alcohol per capita than at any period before or after. In America, most of the states have legislation banning the use of weed. I mean, I saw people smoking weed in a hotel last night. No policing came in and arrested them. So governments always do this. The Congress, the Senate, whatever body within a government that creates laws is foolish enough to think that just because they make cryptocurrencies illegal, that that's going to solve the problem. That we can all go back to work and not worry about Bitcoin. That's the idiocy of governments. They never learn from past experiences. So what is going to happen is legislation in every country in the world banning us. I spoke in Hong Kong in September?
Yes.
Pardon?
Yes.
Yes, okay. I was supposed to speak in Beijing 1 week before the BitCan conference, which is one of the largest crypto conferences in China. China banned ICOs. I was speaking about ICOs. So if I got on stage and talked about it, I would now be in jail in China, learning Chinese and eating rice. So instead, they moved the conference to Hong Kong 1 week. They only had 1 week notice. To our credit as a community, not one speaker did not show up, and the conference was still full. We all had to change our itineraries, our plans, everything, and we showed up in Hong Kong, and it was the most solidifying feeling to speak to a group of people who were all refugees. I got to, we are refugees. The first refugees in an ongoing war that will not end for many years. And we were, and you will all be too at some point. The question is, are you prepared for this war? There'll be no bloodshed, there'll be no harm, but there will be finger pointing, anger, attempts to restrict, examples maybe. Well, I already know what some of the first examples will be. It's going to be the most outspoken asshole among us, which is me. So, but I've had a lifetime of being an example, and I've been in jails in almost every country in the world, so I know that. And it will be brief in any case. So are you prepared, though? Are you prepared for the hostility of your bank? For example, two of our banks that we used, suddenly last month said, we are not accepting any cash from any cryptocurrency exchange. It's coming from Coinbase, fuck you, we're not taking it. Now seriously, that's some scary stuff, isn't it? I mean, what am I going to do? I can't write checks on my Coinbase account. So this is going to continue to happen and become worse and worse. And governments are going to make threats. If you use cryptocurrency, it's 6 months in jail, $10,000 fine. Ignore it. These are empty threats designed to do one thing, create fear. And they've been really successful, starting with Jamie Dimon, then last July and August, who is the chairman of the world's probably second largest bank, America's largest bank, JP Morgan, came out on CNN or CNBC and said, Bitcoin is a fraud. Well, if you guys remember that far back, that's a long time in this community, Bitcoin dropped 40% in value overnight. The following day, I went on CNBC and I called two things a fraud. Number one, Jamie Dimon, and number two, the US dollar. Now, I know this is not a valid comparison, but I said, and at the time, I was one of the largest Bitcoin miners around. It cost me $2,500 to create a Bitcoin. What does it cost to create a $100 bill? 6 cents. Which one is the fraud? Not that the cost of producing something is equivalent to value, but it's the best I could come up with on short notice. So, nevertheless, think about it. We have proof of work, at least in some of the coins. So they are not frauds. Things are worth what people are willing to pay for them. End of story. That's what value is. And at the time, people were willing to pay $6,000 for a Bitcoin. That's what it was worth. There is no fraud. It has a finite number of coins. There's no one behind the curtain going, yes, I'm going to come out with 2 billion coins in 2035. No. No. There's nothing about it that says fraud. There's everything about it that says superiority to any other fiat or any fiat currency. Speed of transaction, ease of use, privacy, anonymity, and most important, at least to me, it is permissionless. Permissionless. What does that mean? It means you are the god of your life financially. That your wallet is your bank. Is it not now? To do a wire transfer, I've got to get out of bed, get into a car, drive down to the bank, and I couldn't even do that until recently. I'd been a year without a license for a DUI. Drive to the bank, fill out some forms. And sometimes the bank would call back and say, well, you have the wrong address on the receiver's side. Well, whose address? The bank's address, the receiver's address? Maybe both. It's a nightmare. Instead, I pick up my smartphone, I copy and paste an address, and hit send, and go back to sleep. Now, which one is the fraud? The one that costs me time and energy and confusion also costs me money. The other, virtually free, depending upon the currency that you use. So we are at war, and you are going to be the soldiers. Now, what are you going to do? Are you going to stand back and hope that nothing touches you and let the rest of us do the dirty work and get the finger pointing and the egg in the face? Don't get some more egg in the face. Or are you going to participate and help? And it's fear that's the killer. What is it that really caused the drop in all the cryptocurrency prices a month and a half ago? Fear. On my Twitter, every day I kept saying, please God, people, see how temporary this is. Even bringing charts up showing every time this year, the same goddamn thing happens. No. Everybody's stopping, oh my God, I'm losing. No, you haven't lost a thing unless you sell. Now what's happening now? Bitcoin is over $10,000. Again, that's not high. It's way better than it was 4 weeks ago. Fear. And who instills the fear? What started all of this? India cracking down with legislation. Banks refusing to accept credit card payments for cryptocurrencies. The SEC making threatening noises and motions. All of this combined frightened some of us. How can you have fear when you are solidly behind an unstoppable force? And that's what we are behind, and that's what we are using, and that is our weapon. A mathematical certainty that we will succeed. And I'm gonna shut up and ask questions, or let you ask questions, because certainly my haters have a list of thousands, so. If you guys will raise your hands first, we'll take you. Yes, sir. Good to meet you. Love you, sir.
A quick question for you is, on November 2nd of last year, there was a fellow named Doug Casey, fairly well known, who said that there's a coin you're coming out with associated with the country of China. Wondering if you'd comment or give us some ideas what might be happening.
Yeah, well, like with most things that I attempt to do with any degree of sincerity, the world smacks me on the head with a hammer. So yeah, I was in fact working with the largest venture fund in all of China. And we were coming out with the McAfee coin, and its purpose was to let you and the people choose where venture funding goes. Instead of some analyst sitting in a room, you know, with glasses and never seeing the light of day, going, well, this idea for a tomato that will roll down a conveyor belt without bruising, we can sell to Monsanto for $1 billion, which doesn't do me any good, because it's going to taste bad anyway. We can go, well, how about this? How about this renewable energy project? Because if you have 50 million people all voting on where money goes to create the basic technology in which our children, and possibly even ourselves, are going to be living, then we're going to have a better world, a far better world. And the venture funders are going to make more money because it's already there. Now, however, China came in and stopped everything. Both the venture fund that I was working with and everything else. So
they were never on board in the first place.
I'm sorry?
Were they ever on board as a country or just people in China that were working with you?
No, it was a venture fund.